all our job is to basically say, did the two other committees that did the legislation, that prepared the legislation, did they follow the reconciliation instructions that the budget committee had given them? It's a technical approach, but I've said that I'm still waiting to see the final legislation before I decide whether I'm going to vote for it or not. And that the legislation was being amended this weekend, and I'm waiting when I get down there to actually see whether the changes were made that I am advocating for. So the main change that I'm looking for in the legislation is I would like the advanced refundable tax credits to be higher for people who are under, say, $45,000 in income, because that will make it more possible for them to purchase insurance with those advanced refundable credits. So it's pretty clear that people who were making a family income more than 50 were doing better under the advanced refundable credits than they might have under the ACA in most instances. And there's always going to be questions, because some people under the ACA got extra incentives or extra subsidies beyond the premium credits they were receiving. So when you're dealing with the complexity of a program like this and the millions of individuals who are affected, it's hard to come up with one rule of thumb. But generally speaking, the people who make more than $45,000 to $50,000 were doing better with the advanced refundable tax credits, particularly if they had a couple of kids, than they were under the ACA. My concern was that the people who were making under that amount weren't doing as well, and it would be more difficult for them to use the credits to purchase suitable insurance. So that's one of the changes that I'm hopeful when I get back to Washington later today, we'll have more clarity on. Because I think that was a fair criticism of the proposal at the outset.
How many people in the district do you anticipate losing health insurance with the enactment of the...
I don't believe that people will lose insurance. I think we will be able to provide alternatives to purchasing insurance. Now, the CBO in their analysis estimated that there would be some 14 million that would lose insurance potentially. But again, that was included people that were getting exemptions and paying the penalty, or getting exemptions from having to pay the penalty now. So it stands to logic that if someone was paying the penalty rather than or had received an exemption from paying the penalty, that those people would probably not buy unless the price could be brought to a point where they would find the cost to be something that they would be willing to pay. One of the reasons for the other thing is that the CBO estimated that over 5 million people would lose Medicaid coverage, which I find to be hard to understand, because right now those folks aren't paying anything for the Medicaid coverage, and the Medicaid expansion would be preserved through the end of 2019, and everyone who had gotten in the Medicaid expansion would still be able to stay on that expansion at the higher rate to the state, at a higher rate of payment to the state. So the CBO analysis, I think, I'm not critical of CBO. Some of my colleagues are. They are responsible for analyzing a bill that comes in front of them as though nothing else changes. And there are other aspects to the regulatory system that Tom Price, the new Secretary of HHS, and the new administrator of CMS, they are going to be making administrative proposals, which I believe will lower the cost of insurance. So CBO, when they did their analysis, couldn't speculate on what those changes would be, because their process doesn't permit that. But clearly, there will be changes that will be made administratively that I believe will lower the cost of insurance. Then there's the topic of age banding, which the ACA had an age banding of ratio of 3 to 1. The proposal in front of us would give the states an option to raise that age banding to 5-1. It's an option. Interesting, the people who came before us, the experts in who do health insurance underwriting and are looking at this from an actuarial standpoint, say that the pure age banding should be about 4.8-1. So the legislation allows it to go to 5-1. So what does this really mean at the end of the day? It means that if the young, healthy people, some of which are around this room here today, in that age bracket, if the young people are incentivized to, by lower costs, to purchase insurance, that will allow the insurers to build the pool of people who are in that group and therefore will lower the costs for the young people and not really raise the costs for the people, the older people within the group. That's the theory, the actuarial theory behind that 5-1 ratio. Very interesting question for us in New York. In New York State, age banding of 3-1 was done in the ACA. That actually had the effect of lowering the costs in the individual market in New York State. Why? Because New York's law has age banding at 1-1, which means you can't charge a 60-year-old any more than you can charge a 20-year-old. Every actuary on the health insurance side that I've talked to, liberal and conservative, people that do this for a living, has told me that what New York State did with that 1-1 rating ratio was they destroyed their individual market for insurance. So the key here is to recognize one essential point on the insurance side of this equation, because we're really dealing with two issues in terms of this whole ACA replacement. One is Medicaid, and one is the insurance side. Now, on the insurance side, who are we talking about here? We're talking mostly about people who do not have employer-provided health insurance. That's the group that we're trying to, that the ACA tried to address and that this legislation tries to address. It comes at it from different angles. But why is this important? There are 170 million people in America that get their insurance through their employer. When you receive your health insurance from your employer, that benefit is not taxable to you. So that's a $350 billion tax subsidy every single year under the tax code that benefits people that have employer-provided health insurance. But what about the people that don't have employer-provided health insurance? They get absolutely no benefit under the tax code to buy insurance, none whatsoever. And what the ACA tried to do with the premium support and what this replacement bill attempts to do through the advanced refundable tax credit is to provide a true cash subsidy to allow people who do not have employer-provided insurance to purchase insurance. That really is what's going on here. That ultimately is, how do you address the people, the man and wife with two kids who are making $45,000 or $50,000, just hypothetically, how do you help them buy insurance when their employer doesn't provide the insurance? So the advanced refundable tax credits are intended to address that group of people.
And can you explain how those work?
Yes. By advance refundable, we mean two things. Advance means you get it up front. You can take a piece of paper to CDPHP or MVP or United Healthcare, any insurance company, and say, I'm going to get this much money to help me pay for insurance. That company then can bill the government directly for your coverage. So that means, that's the term advance. Refundable as a tax credit means you get the benefit even if you owe no taxes. So this is the difference between a tax credit and a deduction. A deduction only benefits someone who's really making more than $50,000, $60,000, $70,000, and it means they can write off the amount of the deduction against their taxable income. A credit, on the other hand, says, even if you owe no taxes, that you have no taxable income to write it against, you still get it. We do this as common in the tax code. We do it under the earned income tax credit for low-income people to help them pay for the costs of if they're working in a minimum wage job or they're making $14 or $15 an hour and they've got a couple of kids. Those people benefit from the earned income tax credit. They don't owe any taxes. They still get the credit. And that is well entrenched in federal and state tax law. I've long supported the earned income tax credit. The difference is the earned income tax credit, you get it only after you file your income taxes. The difference here in this proposal, the advance refundable tax credit, you get it up front. Because you can't wait until April 15 the following year to buy health insurance the year before. So we're trying to create a system whereby the tax credit is something that's very much available to you. And in this respect, the advance refundable tax credit is like a cousin, a first cousin to the premium support that's in the ACA. It is not markedly different in terms of its effect, except that it doesn't require you, the ACA required you only to, you could only use the premium support to purchase a plan which Washington said was eligible for the plan. This advance refundable tax credit will mean any state regulated plan, you're going to be able to use it to buy insurance, not one that Washington says you have to buy.
One of the things that Paul Ryan has been saying is that this is going to help the free market system for health insurance. But there is not a free market system in the world that works for health insurance. Why do you think this is going to work?
Actually, I disagree with the premise of your question. There are free market systems that work. We have it in our country today. And people, for instance, many people don't have dental insurance. How much the filling is going to cost you before you go in. We know how much the crown is going to cost before you go in. People actually ask what the cost is. And as a consequence, there's a free market there. One of the things we're going to do in this legislation that is being proposed is to greatly increase the value of health savings accounts to let people be able to use pre-tax dollars to purchase services like dental insurance. Look in terms of laser surgery for people that want to improve their vision without glasses. The market in laser surgery, the prices have come down tremendously. Cosmetic surgery, the same way. Because people have more of a stake, they have more of a role in terms of the market deciding what they get and what they want to purchase. Now, health insurance is somewhat different. I acknowledge that. But right now we have a system, again, largely with employer-provided health insurance, where people don't ask what does something cost before they use it. So it's no surprise that we've had rampant medical inflation in many instances in years past because there's no economic relationship between the health provider and the consumer. Now again, this is not like going in and shopping in a grocery store. It is more complicated. But many people today are much more educated consumers. The effort is to, through health savings accounts and through some other measures, to make people better educated consumers. When they get their advanced refundable tax credit, they can decide what kind of plan they want. They can go to MVP or CDPHP or another health insurer in the area, and it's not strictly dictated by Washington. But market forces are important to introduce here, to get more market forces introduced, because without market forces, people have no concern as to what something costs. And I think we do need more transparency, where if you go to a hospital and or an orthopedic surgeon and they say, well, your knee replacement is going to cost this many thousands of dollars, that you have a choice. You can go to one orthopedic surgeon over another, one hospital facility over another, and you might evaluate and make critical decisions based on your perception as to the quality, the speed with which you can get your service, etc. So I readily acknowledge that marketplace, we don't have a pure marketplace when it comes to healthcare. We're probably never going to have a pure marketplace, but we should have more market forces in order to make educated consumers pay more attention to what things cost.
But didn't we have that before the ACA?
No. I mean, the ACA hasn't necessarily introduced any market forces whatsoever. In fact, they minimized health savings accounts. They minimized flex spending, that where people would make decisions as to what they wanted to buy, and you pay for their co-payments, etc. So I'm hopeful that, again, there's not going to be a pure market in healthcare because it's too complicated, and at the end of the day, it is not the same as buying other consumer products. But the ACA did not introduce really market principles whatsoever. And I think one of the things that we need is to get more market principles into health spending so that people have more incentive to pay attention to what things cost in the marketplace.
But before the ACA, it wasn't a free market.
No. I mean, we've not had a free market, pure free market, because the health insurance by its nature is heavily regulated by the states. And in New York State, for instance, as I mentioned before, New York State, with its regulation, its age banding, a community rating regulation, literally destroyed the market for individual insurance in our state. Give you an example. In the 20 years before the ACA, New York went from having 1 million people in the individual market to fewer than 20,000 people. It was actually about 17,000 buying individual health insurance in New York State. And the reason was primarily the age banding of 1-to-1, and it made the cost, it just totally destroyed the health insurance pools in the individual market in our state. The only people who would buy individual insurance by the time the ACA was enacted were people who had very high health costs, who were paying $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, even $6,000 per month for their insurance. And that obviously is a system that couldn't be sustained. So New York State, because of its regulatory practices in the past, wrecked our individual market. The ACA actually reduced costs. We were one of the only states where this happened. It actually reduced costs in the individual market because it had 3-to-1 age banding. And this is, you know, this stuff is in the weeds, I think. You know, a lot of people don't consider this, but it's very important for the regulatory pattern to be one that makes sense and is logical and works actuarially. And some people have said, well, this age banding, the AARP said they don't like the age banding provision that's in this law, which again is optional to go to 5-to-1. But think about it from the auto insurance context. If you're a 20-year-old male and you're buying car insurance, guess what? You are actuarially a greater risk than someone that's Ray's age or my age, you know, someone who's over 50. You are actuarially a greater risk. We understand that in the auto insurance context. Similarly, in the health insurance context, people that are my age, 64, cost more on average than people who are 24. If you're going to price this product in an actuarially sound approach, you need to be able to give a significant reduction in cost to that 24-year-old so we get enough of those in the pool to pay for the cost of the 60-year-olds. That's the way insurance works. That's the way they balance the risk, and that's the way they create their pools. And that's something that New York wrecked actually before the ACA, and the ACA was good in that regard because 3-to-1 was a much more logical age banding than 1-to-1.
Okay. He has to go.
No, he's actually got
15
more minutes.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
You didn't know.
No, I didn't know. Sorry. Let's talk about the budget for a second, the proposed budget.
Yes.
How do you feel about it?
I haven't fully studied it, but the things I have seen, I'm not in support of. So we, on the budget committee, we've got to go and rework this, I believe. Okay. There are too many, you know, look, you cannot balance the budget by looking at the small percentage, relatively small percentage of the budget that is in discretionary accounts. And a lot of folks don't realize that fully 65 to 70% of our budget is on automatic pilot. It's interest on the debt, it's Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security. That is like taken off the table. The rest of it is defense and all the domestic spending programs, whether it's the EPA, the National Endowment for the Arts, the Centers for Disease Control, community development block grants. Regardless of what program or agency we're talking about, those are the discretionary accounts. There's very little, you can't balance the budget by just focusing on those areas. There's no doubt we need to improve military readiness, and I think the president is right in trying to emphasize that. But I think the approach of then just looking at domestic discretionary accounts to fund it is not one that's going to pass the Congress.
Question just went out of my head. Has to do with the budget.
Well, I mean, locally, the environment ends, right?
Yeah, well, that and Homeland Security.
We have
the proposed cuts to the city.
We have, there are major concerns. My colleague Peter King, who's used to be the chairman of the Homeland Security Committee, has made it plain that he can't support those. I think that, look, New York City is the focus of attention for a lot of people who would do us harm, because it is the symbol of American free enterprise, and it's the symbol that most people around the world, besides Washington, associate with the United States. We've seen multiple instances where the NYPD and their counterintelligence, counterterrorism branch have foiled plots against our homeland and against the city of New York. There was the Times Square bomber potentially a couple of years ago. And you know, we've got to be vigilant in this regard. So I do think that it's unlikely a lot of these proposals will be enacted. It's not to say that we can't find efficiencies in economies, and I'm certainly all for that. I don't see this proposal getting forward. You may also want to inquire, maybe the question that went out of your mind was about immigration. And you mentioned Homeland Security. I think the president's second executive order is likely to be upheld by the courts. It's much more narrowly crafted, and I opposed the first one because it was not well considered. But I think the larger issue is solving the issue of immigration. Really important that we be able to, for our farmers and for employers in the Hudson Valley and the Catskills, that we have the ability to bring workers in who want to harvest the crop. I've talked to people who are very, very concerned about the supposed crackdown on those who are here in the country illegally. And I'm meeting shortly with people from the Department of Homeland Security, but I have had some preliminary discussions. I've been told that unless someone who's in the country illegally, unless someone has committed a crime or has a criminal record, they should not worry about this process. But I understand that my merely saying that is not going to alleviate the concerns. A lot of this is stoked in social media. But it's important for us, yes, to have border security. And everyone supports border security. How you do it is another question. But at the same time, we should be able to walk and chew gum at the same time. And we should be able to fix the immigration system and the status of people who are here, to normalize that status in the country without creating grave economic troubles and significant consternation among the immigrant community who are here.
We had three gentlemen who were accused of DWI, and they were taken away by ICE when they first went to court. They weren't convicted, they were just taken. And Hudson is a sanctuary city, which is one of nine in the state. How do you feel about that?
Well, again, if someone is here illegally and they commit a crime, I would prefer that the action take place upon conviction as opposed to accusation. so that I think the courts are going to insist that due process be upheld. But again, someone who is here illegally, who is even accused of a crime, has less due process rights in some instances than someone who's here legally. And but my preference would be in those instances that their matters be fully adjudicated before a deportation would take place. I do think it's important if a community receives, we had an instance here in Columbia County where someone who had been convicted of, I think it was child sexual abuse, and had been deported five times previously, was back. I don't have any sympathy for that person. And I think it's really important to draw distinctions between someone who is here, who might actually have children who are U.S. citizens, someone who's here working and not violating any laws, but may not have the right immigration status, that it's important to draw distinctions between those that are here for economic reasons, who may have children who are U.S. citizens, and who are people who are working and living in our community. It's important to draw distinctions between those people and those that have committed crimes.
How do you feel about the wall?
I actually want to go down to the border to see it myself. Speaker Ryan went down a few weeks ago, and he's recommended that all of us go down there and look at it. I've talked to colleagues from Texas and Arizona, and most of them are of the opinion that building a wall per se is not a solution, that there needs to be, in some areas, either technology used, because topography does not permit building a wall. People should not have this impression that you can, they should not have the impression that you can actually build a physical barrier in some of the places along the border. It's not possible. So I want to look closely at the proposal. I also want to go down there, and I intend to go down there to see it for myself. But I'm very concerned about the expenditure of money, which may or may not be necessary. Some place, you know, we have a wall, a physical barrier in many places along the border, hundreds and hundreds of miles. And some areas may need a physical structure like that. Other areas may not need it. And so that's where I want to see it for myself.
I'll give you a break now. Do you want to say anything else?
Five more minutes.
Oh, okay. Excellent. Okay. Anybody have a question?
Climate change?
Yeah.
I joined with the other Republicans recently in co-sponsoring the resolution that Chris Gibson had sponsored last year. I think it's a real issue. I don't think it's a made-up issue. The question is, how do you improve the environment while not hurting our economy? And that's the key thing in a region like ours where we're losing jobs and we've got to slack measures that would, in the name of protecting the climate, that would unduly and unfairly impact the economy in our area. But on the other hand, I want us to continue the progress that we've made and recognizing that we need to harden infrastructure and deal with flood mitigation and take steps that will lessen this, but we also need to work internationally because other countries, it's not going to make much impact if we take measures that other countries do not. And I also joined a caucus of Democrats and Republicans in the House that will address this issue as well. So my approach is that we need to move forward and work on this very conscientiously.
It's nice to hear that you don't think it's a hoax.
No. Go ahead.
I just want to call scheduled?
We got a lot of people on the line. And, you know, you make the call, but we had over 1,000 people sign up ahead of time, and all of those people got calls. And I realized that, you know, I can't speak to every instance and what the technology is, and some people may get the call and not realize what it is. So We'll try to do it better next time. It was our first time doing it as a member of Congress. I did it about three times during the campaign last year. But this system that we used, I think, is a good way of reaching people. And, you know, in a district like ours, we go from Vermont in the Northeast to Pennsylvania in the Southwest with people contemporaneously like we did in that town hall. And I would also note that I'm doing a live 1 hour on WMHT, which is the major public broadcasting station. That's going to be, I think, April 13th. And people can go to WMHT's website, as long as they're constituents, and sign up to either watch in the studio. There are a limited number of seats. I think it's about 80 people that would be in the studio. But I'll reach many thousands of more people doing a live TV program than I would any other way. But I've been meeting with people individually and in groups all throughout the district for months now.
When you say the WMHT thing, is that going to be someone interviewing you like we are, or are people in the audience going to ask you questions?
The latter. People in the audience are going to ask questions.
Okay. Where do you stand on Neil Gorsuch?
He's a great nominee. He's a terrific nominee. He's got a great record. I've read some of his opinions. I think he has judicial temperament. He's definitely someone that interprets the Constitution in a way that's consistent with the constitutional provisions and also statute. He's rendered important decisions relating to religious liberty, which I think are really important. And he also has a more skeptical view of agencies. And I think that's really important because we have allowed the administrative agencies to almost become a fourth branch of government. And part of that is the fault of Congresses, Democrat and Republican, where they enact statutes that are imprecise and vague and leave too much discretion to the administrative agency. So I'm not simply saying, oh, the agencies are bad. Congress adopts statutes that are vague and imprecise. And so the agencies are left trying to figure out what did Congress mean. I think that his opinion on reining in the discretion of administrative agencies is one that I agree with, and it's the so-called Chevron doctrine, which is about a 20-year-old case and the U.S. Supreme Court decided. So Scalia was on the other side, I think, of that Chevron case, and I think Gorsuch, by his writings, would indicate that he takes a different view. But I think he's an excellent nominee.
International relations. How do you think things are going so far this year?
Well, I'm concerned about some of the statements that we've heard from the president on, particularly as it relates to Mexico and some of our allies. I do think that Secretary Tillerson and Defense Secretary Mattis have reassured our allies about NATO. Very important that we get NATO countries to contribute their fair share to defense, and I think that's what irks the president the most. A lot of those countries have given us lip service in years past, and I think he's trying to negotiate a better deal. I think we just have to be very careful and prudent in terms of our international relations. And here's one thing. In the budget, back to the president's proposed budget, cutting the State Department and our diplomatic efforts and some of the peaceful means we try to influence public opinion favorably to the United States abroad, I don't support that. I think it's a lot cheaper to do international democracy building programs than to fight wars. So I think it's really important that we give a very, very small percentage of the budget. It's less than a tenth of a percent or 0.2% of our budget goes to so-called foreign aid. And most Americans don't realize that, but I understand it. And I really think a lot of those programs are important for us to put a very good foot and face forward for the United States around the world. So, and you know, if we don't act in this way, some of our adversaries and competitors, like China, will move into the void. So it's important that we not, pull in, think that that the two oceans on either side protect us from the forces of evil around the world. It's very important the United States be a force for good and for democracy and free enterprise around the world. I think I am...
Time?
Yeah.